So first up is Vivek.
Thank you, Adriano. And again, let me just stress, this conference, successful as it has been the product of the labor of students, graduate students, who toiled for untold hours for no reward other than to feel that they've contributed to the left in these woebegotten times. So again, on my behalf, many, many thanks to the students for doing this. I also want to thank Barbara and Partho for coming, and I hope this does turn out to be a productive discussion amongst all of us. The title of this debate was given to us as Marxism and the Legacy of Subaltern Studies. And I just wanted to start by just motivating the question a little bit as to what's at stake here. Subaltern Studies is largely known as an extremely influential and highly productive stream of history and theorizing that's come out of South Asia, but has emerged as a very important way of thinking not just about India or Pakistan or other countries in South Asia, but of the global South, and then, even more, of capitalism more generally. Now, that alone makes it, I think, a very important project to think about, because it has positioned itself, I think correctly, as an important contributor to the development of radical and critical thought in the late 20th, early 21st century. But even more, the annual volumes that were associated with it, and the original editorial collective, officially or semi-officially sort of rolled up a few years ago, called it an end. I'm not sure, I think the volumes might be coming out still, but they're under a different editorial direction. And it allows us to now stand back and take stock of what it has achieved, what its contributions have been, and what perhaps its shortcomings were. Its main arguments, I feel, are not only important, but they have seeped into much of the common sense of the left, especially in universities. So much so that it is, I think, even amongst people who now seek to go beyond subaltern studies and seek to go beyond what we know as beyond what's known as post-colonial theory, many of the claims that come out of the strand of theorizing are now taken as so obvious that they don't need to be questioned. And indeed, in recent papers by Dipesh Chakrabarty and Partha Chatterjee, both of which sort of write an afterword, a coda to subaltern studies, shortcomings are pointed out. Certain misgivings are pointed out by both of these theorists. What is left out, however, are many of the issues that I will be bringing up tonight. So while it's certainly true that the editorial collective has been open to criticism and self-criticism, it may not be of the kind that is warranted once we examine their claims. Now, what is known to be, or what is associated with subaltern studies that's worth thinking about? The project, and I think more generally post-colonial theory as well, or if there's such a thing as post-colonial theory, is known in some large measure for two particular sets of claims. It's not all it's known for, and subaltern studies is certainly not exhaustive of post-colonial theory, but it is a highly influential stream within it, and these two particular claims that I'm going to focus on do lie, I would argue, at the heart, at the very core of what its contributions have been. And it is these claims that I think that I would like to examine tonight. One is this concept of difference. The basic idea there is that there is a very important, very deep difference in the cultural, political, and sociological makeup of the Western world, or the advanced capitalist world, and the colonial and post-colonial world. Secondly, is the critique of Eurocentrism. The notion that theories coming out of the West quite often obscure or get in the way of a proper understanding of the non-Western world, and are guilty of projecting onto that world claims, understandings that are really much more defensible only with regard to Europe. And it's an illicit expansion of claims that have some warrant for the European experience, not so much, however, outside the European experience. Now, it's important to understand that the claim for the difference of the colonial and post-colonial world from the experience of the West has not been unique to subaltern studies or to post-colonial theory, It is, in fact, an argument that has been made by many parts of the left across the 20th century, including the Marxist left. Indeed, among Marxists, the argument that non-Western parts of the world are not directly following in the tracks of the West was made as early as 1905 in the wake of the first Russian Revolution and continued to be made again and again and again in the anti-colonial movements of the mid-century, in the national liberation movements, and even in countries where there wasn't any kind of social revolution. Marxists recognized that the East is not developing as a mirror image of the West. So the claim to difference is not unique nor new. What sets subaltern studies apart, however, is how deep and how far-reaching its claims are about difference. In the Marxist tradition, no matter how much it was recognized that the East is different from the West, and I'll use East and West as these shorthands for the advanced capitalist world and the rest. It also encompasses Latin America, but I'm following their own locution here. In the Marxist left, it was understood that no matter how deep those differences are, they don't go all the way down. And two kinds of commonalities between the East and the West were stressed in particular. One had to do with capitalism. Ever since the publication of the Communist Manifesto, Marxists insisted that whatever differences there might be between the Western world and the rest, differences of culture, differences in the economies, differences in the institutional structures, as capitalism grew out of the West, it became an increasingly universal system in its scope. As capitalism spread across the world, its properties were universalized in some way. And in that way, along with that, the theory of how to understand capitalism also gained in its applicability and hence in its universality beyond the region of its origin. Secondly, there was a claim about resistance, that as capitalism spreads across the world, as it implants itself, it comes up against resistance on the part of social agents, of actors all across the world, who see that capitalism as a threat to their well-being, and hence as a threat to their own interests. Following on that was a claim, as a corollary, that as capitalism threatens the interests and the well-being of people all across the world, of working people all across the world, those people also generate and discover a common interest in fighting against it. And this was to be the material substratum that bound together working people around the world in a common struggle against capitalism. This was what we would know, what we would say their common humanity, a common set of needs and a common set of interests. Now, these two commitments have been foundational to the left since its birth. Subaltern studies, however, increasingly has called them into question and in some cases, indeed, urged for their rejection. And this is what I would wish to question today. Now, you might ask, how can it call into question that capitalism is spreading across the world? I mean, it seems to be an empirical fact. Subaltern theorists don't question that capitalism has globalized. In fact, they seek to draw a distinction between capital's globalization and its universalization. So Dipesh Chakrabarty, in Provincializing Europe, says that the globalization of capital is not the same as capital's universalization. This is a direct quote. It's from page 71 of Provincializing Europe. Let me say it again. The globalization of capital is not the same as capital's universalization. Now, attendant upon that, then, is the claim, of course, that the theories of capitalism that came out of the West, therefore, also lack universal scope. And we'll see later this is why they are Eurocentric. Now, what would this claim mean? What does it mean to say that capital has not been universalized even though it's been globalized? Well, what they mean by that is that even as it spreads across into the East, what it fails to transmit is certain properties that we commonly associate with capitalism. So it's the properties that are not being universalized, even though something called capitalism is being globalized. And there are two arguments about the failure to transmit properties, two distinct arguments for how capital fails to universalize. One has come from Ranjit Guha. This was in the very first volume of Subaltern Studies, and it was most elaborated in a book that he published, which brought together his essays in 1997, called Dominance Without Hegemony. And what Guha says is, a successful universalizing capitalism universalizes one specific property, which is a specific kind of political culture. This political culture is the rule by capital on the basis of the consent of working people, of the subaltern classes. What is universalized in a truly universalizing capitalism is rule by consent. The bourgeoisie creates a coherent political culture and manages successfully to not only strive for its own interests, but to what he calls speak for the entire nation. What happens in the West, he said, is that capital did successfully speak for the entire nation through the onset of what he called, what we would now call, the bourgeois democratic revolution, the revolutions of 1640 in England, the 1789 in France. These revolutions were not only victories for the bourgeoisie politically, he says, but they were also transformations of the political culture such that the bourgeoisie managed to bring in subaltern agents into a coalition, successfully coordinate with their interests, and garner their consent and in the construction of a liberal, encompassing, democratic political order. In the East, however, the bourgeoisie failed to universalize these properties. In the colonial and the post-colonial world, what the bourgeoisie did instead was to abjure the capture of consent and instead rule simply by outright domination through some kind of dictatorships and oligarchies. In so doing, it failed to transform the political culture. In so doing, it failed to transform subaltern cultures. It didn't break apart old forms of political practice, political idioms, political institutions, and what the non-Western world was left with, therefore, was two separate spheres, an elite sphere and a subaltern sphere, and the subaltern sphere continued to carry on with its own culture from pre-capitalist days, changed but not fundamentally transformed. And most importantly, its own forms of consciousness, which were no longer to be bourgeois consciousness, but consciousness overlain with all sorts of hangovers from the past. Well, that's one argument. The second argument has come from debate structure, but at the end it goes something like this. The property that is universalized in a truly successfully universalizing capitalism is that it transforms all social relations such that they become reflective of the logic of capital. So what a successful capitalism does when it universalizes is it changes not just the economy, but everything, the culture, the political the political institutions, etc. What happens in the East is this fails to occur, and instead what capitalism has to accommodate to is the enduring obduracy of local practices, local cultures, local institutions, and therefore it has to accommodate to them. And insofar as it accommodates to them, it fails to universalize. And since it fails to universalize in this way, it generates a capitalism that is entirely different from the capitalism of the West, where it did transform all these social relations, at least far more so. He's a little vague on this, but the implication is far more so than it does in the East. The result, again, if you just take the categories that Marx and the Enlightenment tradition gave us to understand capitalism and you transport them to the East, they inevitably distort the realities of the East because they assume that agents work with a culture and on goals that Western agents do, but they don't. They assume that institutions and organizations look like those of the West, but they don't. And they, therefore, these theories impart to them or impute to them, the institutions, organizations, a logic that they don't actually have, and hence they distort. Well, what do we make of both of these arguments? Well, what I've tried to argue in the book is neither of them can withstand scrutiny. With regard to the first argument about the universe, about the rule by consent, Guha works with a largely fictional understanding of European history. It is true that in the East, capitalists often resorted to dictatorships, to oligarchies, etc. But the fact is, for the first 150 to 200 years of capitalist history, that is exactly what happened in the West. What capitalists put in place in the West in 1640, in 1789, or any of the transformations that occurred subsequently were bourgeois oligarchies. And insofar as they were democratized, it was not a consequence of the bourgeoisie striving for a liberal consensual order. It was the consequence of struggle from below, which wrested away these liberties from the bourgeoisie through mass struggle, with the bourgeoisie kicking and screaming every step of the way and fighting against them. The transformation, therefore, insofar as it did occur, was not a consequence of capital's universalizing tendencies, its tendency to transform political cultures. They were a consequence of struggles from below. What capital implanted in the West, therefore, was very much the kind of dominance without hegemony that it is accused of doing in the East in a unique experience which departs from the West. So insofar as capital did in the East follow the path of establishing its rule through force, it was very much in the way, in the tracks that it laid for the West. This divergence between East and West, therefore, is difficult to sustain. What about Chakrabarti's claim that insofar as capitalism fails to transform everything, it has failed to universalize? Well, it's hard to think of anybody in the history of left thought who ever said that this is the litmus test for capitalism's universalization. What we've always said is that for capitalism to actually become dominant in a particular geographical region, for it to implant itself and to become the system that gives that region its engine, its motor force for historical development, it does have to transform things, but not everything. It fundamentally has to transform the way in which production and distribution is carried out. It has to transform how production, the economy is run. For to call a country capitalist is to say that its production and distribution is carried out on a market-dependent basis. Now, it is true that this will also bring in train cultural changes, political changes. But there's no reason to think it has to change everything. Capitalists are perfectly happy with traditional rituals. In fact, they'll oftentimes promote them if it helps them divide people, if it helps them make themselves seem legitimate. In fact, it directly generates all kinds of heterogeneity. To see that heterogeneity, therefore, is a failure of capital's universalization is a theoretical error. Indeed, within post-colonial theory, it is very common to see the argument that universalizing claims that come out of Marxism, that when Marxists say this is capitalist and that's capitalist, that Detroit's capitalist and Nairobi's capitalist, that Mumbai is capitalist and Manchester is capitalist, it assumes homogeneity across cultures. That's absolutely false. All it says is they share in certain properties, which is that both of these, in all these regions, production has to be subordinated to the profit motive. There will be changes that come with that, but it's an open-ended question how far-reaching those changes have to be. What that means in turn is that the categories that we've often used to describe these areas can very well be modified categories, modified versions of the categories we use to understand the West. Now, let me move on to the second thing, the issue of interests. Marxists have always held that there are certain common interests that people have across cultures that bind them together, that give them a common humanity. What we often find people in the theorists of subaltern studies saying increasingly is that this is a problematic claim. It assumes, they say, a kind of bourgeois consciousness on the part of workers, a consciousness that is typical only of the modern bourgeois era, or we hear that this is reducing people to a certain utilitarian logic. It denies them their culture. But none of this is true. The claim that people have certain common interests is perfectly compatible with the recognition that they have very many different cultural mores, that they live in different cultures, that they have different conceptions of what's good and what's bad, that they have different goals in their life and different good conceptions even of the self. It only says that these cultural differences don't go all the way down. It only says that however deep the cultural differences are, however enmeshed they are in their particular local cultures, they still have an idea of what conduces to their well-being, their physical well-being, and what does not. That they still are able to recognize when they're being oppressed, when they're being dominated, and when they're not. Subaltern studies has one particular contradiction in this regard. Its theorists often agree that wherever there is domination and oppression, there's going to be resistance. Marxists agree with that too. When Marx says all of history is the history of class struggle, what he's saying is wherever there's exploitation, regardless of the culture, there will be resistance to it, and that generates a struggle. How do you maintain this and also maintain that agents are simply the product of their culture? Every culture tries to normalize domination. Every culture tries to justify exploitation, to show it as not only natural but also legitimate. If agents were simply the creation of their cultures, agents would also internalize fully and successfully the normalization of their condition, but they don't. Well, if they don't, what are the psychological resources that they draw upon when they resist? Well, the Marxist response has been their interests, their needs, which may be modified by their culture. It may be The form in which they're expressed may be shaped by their culture, but it's not invented by the culture. And this is why resistance can extend across from one place to the other. In my view, the claim, therefore, that to refer to interests independently of culture is not a sign of reductionism or treating people as atomistic agents or imbuing them with a utilitarian logic. It is simply a recognition of the brute fact that people know what's good for them when it comes to certain basic needs that they might have. Now, if you accept both of these arguments that I've tried to lay out, it calls into question at least these core commitments that subaltern studies has carried with it, some of them through very early stages of their project, others at a more advanced stage in the project. But these are commitments that not only are they known for, but they're very widely perceived across the spectrum of post-colonial theory. If taken seriously, they lead to the view that there is a chasm, an unbridgeable chasm that separates the East from the West, that Eastern agents cannot be viewed through the same lens as those in the West, that the dynamics of countries in the East are not explicable through the categories we saw in the West. Well, there is some truth to this, of course. As I said, cultural specificity is very much true. But to insist that the chasm between them is unbridgeable does two things. First of all, it makes it very difficult to argue that there is such a thing as human rights, that there are rights that all of us have, regardless of our culture and regardless of our wherever we've grown up, regardless of our place. It is very hard to then also say that what is driving the Indian system today, or the South African, or the Argentinian, is capitalism. Variants of it, no doubt. Modified versions of it, no doubt. But capitalism. And finally, this has to be said, it ends up being a license to an unrelenting exoticism about the East, to a revived Orientalism, to a revival of the very ideology that anti-colonial and nationalist movements and left-wing movements for 150 years have fought against. This notion that Eastern people have their own sense of time, their own sense of self, that they don't have a bounded sense of self, that they don't respond to material incentives, that they don't have a concept of the individual. Well, this is very familiar to any of us who come from these parts of the world. This was colonial ideology. In the United States, this was part of the ideology of imperial aggression across the 20th century. And yet it's common. It's common throughout post-colonial studies. You see it in the work of Anibal Quijano outside of subaltern studies in Latin America. You see it in Arturo Escobar. You see it even in people like Boaventura de Sousa Santos, who does tremendous work. But all of them work with this notion that indigenous, peasant, tribal communities just don't think like the rest of us. Well, yeah, they're very different from us. But they think like a lot like us on certain basic issues, and that's why we respect them. Just to say that indigenous communities have cultures that have to be respected is a affirmation of a universalistic claim, the claim that every culture should be respected. It is a form of universalism. But the denial, the suspiciousness of universalism that comes out of certain parts of post-colonial theory and post-colonial studies, that suspiciousness is very hard to sustain unless you also embrace a thoroughgoing ethnocentrism. Well, on the left, this would be a disaster. I'll simply close with this. It is often said among post-colonial theorists that the reason we are suspicious of universalisms is that many of the depredations of imperialism and colonialism were carried out in the name of certain universal goals, universal aspirations, in the name of democracy, in the name of liberality, in the name of freedom. And therefore, we should be suspicious of universals. Well, that's a quite spectacular non sequitur. If somebody carries out a horrendous act in the name of a universalism, what you should be suspicious of is the person carrying out the act, not the universalism. Everything bad that's ever been done in the modern era was done in the name of something good. It doesn't mean you become suspicious of that which is good. Because these universalisms, democracy, liberalism, equal rights, every one of these was the product of struggles from below. For them to become part of our cultures required 2 centuries of struggle. I think on the left, If we start now doubting the veracity, the usefulness of these concepts, well, it is certainly an affront to the centuries of struggle that made them common parlance for us. But it is also, I believe, a tremendous obstacle for any future gains that we might be able to do in these horrible times when the left is flat out on its back, defeated, and desperately seeking some way of becoming relevant again. I look forward to Partha's response.
Thank you, Vivek. Subaltern Studies has been criticized virtually from the moment of its birth, 1982. And as one of the people involved in that project, I've often had found myself in this position, having to respond to criticisms off and on over the last 30 years. And the most recent statements of this, Vivek referred to this, was made last year in an article called After Subaltern Studies. Vivek Chibber's book is the latest and one of the most seriously argued book-length criticisms of Subaltern Studies published in the last 30 years. So since I had the chance of reading the book in the last week, I think I will engage with Vivek's arguments. Most of these are precisely the arguments he makes in the book, but I will do so in terms of what he says in the book, because there are many interesting details of the argument which come out much more explicitly in the book. So Chibber first spoke about Ranjit Guha and his article Dominance Without Hegemony. His criticism, Chibber rejects Guha's criticisms of the bourgeois democracy of post-colonial India as a dominance without hegemony by arguing that no bourgeois revolution, not even the English Revolution of the 1640s or the French Revolution of 1789, was hegemonic in Guha's sense. Chibber's refutation of Guha is, however, based on a gross misunderstanding of Guha's claim. It should be obvious from a reading of Guha's longish essay that it was intended as a critique of liberal historiography and the liberal ideology it represented, and not as a historical sociology of bourgeois revolutions of Europe, as Chibber understands it to be. The short section entitled The Universalizing Tendency of Capital and Its Limitations, from which Chibber quotes quite extensively, was meant to draw out two major claims of the liberal ideology. The universalizing tendency of capital is something claimed by liberal historiography. So is the description of the revolutions of England and France as establishing bourgeois hegemony in the sense of being able to speak for all of society. Guha buttresses these two well-known liberal claims by citing Marx from the Grundrisse on the universalizing tendency and from his 1848 articles on the achievement of the bourgeois revolutions in England and France in bringing about the victory of a new social order. Guha remarks that taken in isolation from Marx's critique of capital in his larger body of work, these statements, quote, I'm quoting from Guha, would make him indistinguishable from any of the myriad 19th century liberals who saw nothing but the positive side of capital in an age when it was growing from strength to strength. But of course, we know that Marx also suggests that capital must come up against limits it cannot overcome. But more on that later. The crucial point is that nowhere in the essay does Guha offer any propositions of his own that might be construed as a historical sociology of bourgeois revolutions in England and France. Indeed, he does not need to make any such sociological claims at all. All he needs is, first, an account of liberal claims that the new social order established by the bourgeoisie enjoyed the consent of all classes in society and was therefore hegemonic in its power. Second, he needs an account of liberal claims that British rule in India also enjoyed a similar basis of consent from Indian subjects. Third, he needs an account of claims by Indian liberals that India's post-colonial order was also hegemonic in the same way that the European bourgeoisie was hegemonic, because the Indian liberal bourgeoisie could legitimately speak on behalf of the entire nation. Finally, Guha needs to show that these liberal claims to hegemony for the colonial as well as the post-colonial regimes are spurious. That is what the essay is designed to achieve. He needs to make no claims of his own about the real history of bourgeois revolutions in Europe. Consequently, Chibber's elaborate exercise of summarizing the real history of the English and French revolutions to show that the English Revolution was not anti-feudal, because feudalism in England had already come to an end, or that the French bourgeois revolutionaries were not capitalists, is entirely beside the point. This demonstration does nothing to Guha's argument. All it does is assert that Marx's description of the historical character of those revolutions was inaccurate in the light of the findings of historians writing at the turn of the 21st century. Similarly, Chibber's charge that Guha holds a Whig view of history is also misplaced. The Whig view is not Guha's, but unsurprisingly, of historians of a Whig persuasion who are in fact the targets of Guha's critique. Further, on the specific point about the French Revolution, it is clear that when Guha talks about the Indian bourgeoisie in the 19th and 20th century, he does not mean capitalists in particular. In fact, he does not anywhere use the term capitalist to describe this group. What he means is the political intellectual leadership of the liberal nationalist movement, which came from the intermediate strata, i.e. the middle class, wedged between the traditional aristocracy and the lower orders of laboring people. That is to say, precisely the bourgeoisie in the French sense of the word, who comprised the bulk of the third estate. Unlike what Chibber surmises, nothing that Guha says about the Indian bourgeoisie is meant to apply specifically to Indian capitalists. But Chibber's examination of the assumed counterfactual of European bourgeois hegemony as against Indian bourgeois non-hegemony sheds light on an interesting question regarding the method of historical comparison. Chibber's exercise requires the assumption that India's 20th century shares the same historical time space as England's 17th and France's 18th. Or else, how could we map the constitutive elements of the English or French Revolution onto the field of victory of the Indian bourgeoisie in the mid-20th century and arrive at our comparative assessments? But this assumption is patently invalid. The reason lies precisely in the fact that the justificatory claims of liberal ideology had permeated deep into the structures of rule in colonial India through the 19th century and were inherited by the triumphant Indian bourgeoisie in the mid-20th. British rule in India had to be justified before the British Parliament and public, as well as its potential Indian critics, not by the standards of 17th century ideology, but by contemporary standards of 19th century liberalism. If ruling India required deviating from some of those standards, the justification could not proceed by rejecting the universal validity of those liberal norms. Rather, arguments had to be constructed on why the specific situation in India required an exception to be made to the universal norm. The colonial history of India is replete with examples of such exceptions. As a consequence, when the Indian nationalist bourgeoisie rejected the allegedly exceptional status of colonial India and assumed power in the sovereign post-colonial nation state, it too justified its rule not by the standards of 17th or 18th century Europe, but by the highest standards of 20th century liberalism. The best proof of this is the Indian Constitution of 1950, designed to match up to the most advanced liberal constitutional standards available anywhere in the world. Equally telling is the litany of pro-imperial historians describing Indian independence not merely as a gift, but indeed as a fulfillment of liberal British rule. Hence, the historical counterfactual to the non-hegemonic character of the Indian bourgeoisie is not the English bourgeoisie of the 17th century or the French bourgeoisie of the 18th. It is the bourgeoisie of the nations of Western Europe and North America after World War II. That is the test to which Guha subjects the post-colonial Indian state. It is a test that its liberal bourgeois leadership had itself welcomed. And it is a test that Guha concludes the Indian bourgeoisie has failed. Its hegemony is spurious, its rule is mere dominance in which the element of coercion far exceeds that of consent. It is also significant, even though Chibber does not notice it, that the whole essay is only, quote, a preamble to an autocritique. That's the title of the last section in Guha's essay. Returning to the theme of the universalizing tendency of capital, Guha notes in his concluding section that liberal ideology fails to see the intrinsic limits to capital self-expansion and the points of resistance it can never overcome. Yet, even anti-colonial historiography had failed to see this. It was yet to launch a serious critique of capital. For Guha, the fight against liberal historiography was thus only the first step to an anti-colonial critique of capital. Let me come to Chibber on Chakravarti. Chibber roundly criticizes Chakravarti for regarding formal equality and impersonal power relations as quintessential aspects of capitalist power. Where Chakravarti reads the persistence, indeed the reproduction, of coercive methods within the industrial labor process and of the consciousness of religious, caste, and other cultural differences among the industrial working class as a limit that colonial capital had been unable to surpass, Chibber regards those features as entirely compatible with capitalism in general. Chakravarti derives the essential conditions of capitalist production from a fairly conventional reading of Marx. Chibber, in rejecting this reading, offers an alternative account of capitalist production that does not have any recognizable relation to the Marxist tradition. The differences between the two approaches are striking and deserve attention. Chakravarti had derived his understanding of the universalizing tendency of capital from Marx's analysis of the logic of capitalist accumulation. It's the dynamic of accumulation that pushed European capital to seek overseas territories where it could find raw material and labor suitable for employment in production. But there, capital encountered social forms of existence of labor it could not transform into homogeneous abstract labor. Industrial production under colonial conditions thus posed, says Chakravarti, an obstacle to the universalizing tendency of capital. Chibber offers an entirely different account of what the universalizing tendency of capital means. The universalizing process is underway, declares Chibber, his words, which he repeated today. If the universalizing process is underway, if agents' reproductive strategies shift towards market dependence. In other words, as he repeats, what is universalized under the rule of capital are the compulsions of market dependence. Now, it is hard to understand how market dependence alone can be a sufficient criterion for the universalization of capital. For instance, one can imagine a system of simple commodity production by owner producers completely dependent on the market, but not employing wage labor, and thus not engaging in capitalist production. Marx was emphatic that capitalist production could only take place when capital owns the means of production, but must find a mass of wage laborers who have no means of production of their own. There must, in other words, first take place a so-called primitive or primary accumulation, which brings about the dissociation of a mass of laborers from their means of labor. Without this, there is no capitalist production. It is only because of the emergence of free and alienable labor power that can be bought and sold like any other commodity that abstract labor can appear as the common measure of all concrete forms of labor employed in capitalist production. Abstract labor is not a meaningful category for any form of production other than the capitalist one. While this definition from Marx is a major pillar of Chakravarti's argument, Chibber rejects Marx's definition of abstract labor. Instead, he insists that abstract labor is a measure of the labor's productive efficiency, which is brought about by the competitive conditions of the production of exchange values. Abstract labor for him measures, this, he says, these are his words, socially necessary levels of efficiency of the laborer. Bizarrely, he invokes Marx's definition of socially necessary labor time as the canonical support for his argument. But how could the production of exchange values itself bring about an abstract measure of socially necessary levels of efficiency? Even in pre-capitalist modes of production, where particular commodities may be produced for exchange in the market, there could exist socially recognized measures of efficiency in specific branches of the concrete labor process. Thus, in small peasant agriculture or crafts manufacture, there may well exist an accepted norm of average efficiency in, let us say, harvesting a specific crop or planing a log of wood. But how could there be a common measure of socially necessary levels of efficiency across all branches of manufacturing in an economy unless labor has been turned into labor power, i.e. a commodity that can be bought and sold in the market. How could capitalists or anyone else speak of benchmark levels of efficiency that apply generally to the manufacture of clothes, shoes, automobiles, missiles, and every other commodity, unless there is first a common measure for labor as a commodity? That common measure, we know from Marx, is abstract labor. Marx is so explicit and elaborate in explaining this his concept of abstract labor that there can be little confusion about its meaning. Abstract labor is that common homogeneous element that enters into the production of all commodities by virtue of the fact that they are all products of the employment of labor power as a commodity. Even though the concrete labor processes are heterogeneous, labor power as a commodity is the same across all branches of production. Like all commodities, labor power too has value, which, like the value of all other commodities, is given by the value of the commodities required for its production. In the case of labor power, this amounts to the value of the commodities required to reproduce for the next period of production the labor power expended in the previous period. In short, the value of one unit of labor power is the value of the subsistence goods required to reproduce that unit for the next period of production. Marx says that under capitalist production, there is an average labor time socially necessary for its reproduction. Quote from Marx, "In a given country, in a given period, the average amount of the means of subsistence necessary for the worker is a known datum. In branches of production that require labor of higher skill or efficiency than the average, the value of labor time is expressed as multiples or complex combinations of simple or average labor power. This means that it requires greater expenditure on subsistence goods to reproduce labor power of higher or more complex quality. Hence, it must be paid more." What this means is that in capitalist production, there can be no independent determination of socially necessary levels of efficiency of labor. They can only be derived from the prevailing average value of labor power in the economy, i.e. from abstract labor as the common homogeneous dimension of labor power as a commodity. Following this definition, the problem that Chakraborty poses is this: did capitalist industrial production in colonial Bengal succeed in establishing abstract labor as the common measure of labor power? His evidence suggests, for instance, that the Brahmin worker in the jute mill claimed to need more subsistence goods than his lower caste fellow workers because of the obligations of his caste. Others needed to keep the women of their families in the village because it was dishonorable for women to live and work in the urban slum. The role of the labor contractor or sardar in controlling, often coercively, the economic and social life of the worker and the dependence of mill managers on those coercive controls is a major feature of Chakraborty's account. Finally, Chakraborty details the way in which Calcutta jute mill workers in the 1930s and 1940s, even as they came together under communist trade unions in struggles against their employers, frequently broke into violent religious conflicts among themselves on questions of political allegiance. Chakraborty interprets this evidence as the lack of freedom of the industrial worker in colonial Calcutta. In other words, the worker here is not, strictly speaking, proletarianized. He or she still retains organic links with peasant production in the rural areas, and despite working for the large part in the urban factory, his or her subsistence needs for the reproduction of labor power, which includes the reproduction of the family, is partly met by the rural peasant economy. Chakraborty's point is that this situation cannot be assumed to be transitional, something that would in due time give way to the general sway of free proletarian wage labor. Rather, this structure of relations was systematically reproduced under conditions of colonial capitalism. Hence his claim that the jute worker's political culture did not split him into his public and private selves and relegate, quote, all distinctions based on birth to the sphere of the private. Thus, says Chakraborty, the jute mill worker had never been politically emancipated from religion. Chibber excoriates Chakraborty for this statement, accusing him of all manner of crimes ranging from obscurity to Orientalism, but does not notice that Chakraborty here is directly paraphrasing Marx on the Jewish question. the early text in which the latter had set out the conceptual conditions for the emergence of the abstract citizen subject of the modern state under the rule of capital. By contrast, Chibber does not find in Chakravarti's evidence any reason to doubt the universalizing spread of capital, since he claims the persistence, reproduction, and manipulation of racial, ethnic, or religious divisions among laborers is fully consistent with capitalist production in general. The difference in perspective is brought out most sharply in Chibber's discussion of the question of peasant consciousness as depicted by historians of subaltern studies. He didn't talk about this very much today, but I will nevertheless, because this is an important part of his argument. Repeatedly, Chibber refers to their alleged claim, expressed most elaborately by Chatterjee, that peasants and industrial workers in the East have a wholly different psychology from those in the West. Those are Chibber's words. Or that the political psychology of Western workers revolved around secular conceptions of religious rights, whereas those of Eastern peasants were motivated by community and religious obligations. The peculiar fact is that, to the best of my knowledge, of the few million words that Chatterjee has published in the last 40 years, he has not used the word psychology a single time, not even once, let alone the phrase political psychology. When historians of subaltern studies speak of peasant consciousness, the academic discipline they invoke most often is not psychology, but anthropology. In fact, one of the achievements of their work is to bring within the field of Marxist discussion the remarkable body of scholarship produced by social anthropologists of South Asia since the 1950s. The empirical work of anthropologists has brought to light, for instance, the evolving institutions and practices of local power in the countryside from colonial times to the present, of caste, not so much as the doctrinal construct of religious or legal texts, but as practiced in actual social situations, or of the changing political significance of religious practices. The overwhelming demonstration of these anthropological studies is the immense heterogeneity of practices, especially in rural South Asia, that defy conventional orderings imposed by Indological or colonial scholarship. This is the empirical evidence that subaltern studies scholars writing in the 1980s and 90s wanted to introduce into Marxist debates over the nature of the post-colonial state and the transition to capitalism. Consequently, when Chakravarti or Chatterjee speak about the consciousness of community among peasants or industrial workers, they take pains to situate that consciousness within specific, empirically described historical contexts of space and time, precisely to avoid reducing the concept of community into some orientalist or romantic trope. Chibber expresses surprise that the story that Chatterjee tells of the Bengal peasantry is a thoroughly materialist one. Nonetheless, says Chibber, Chatterjee insists that Indian peasants were motivated purely by their perceived duty to the group with little or no consideration of their individual self-interests. Chibber's attribution is completely wrong. Nowhere does Chatterjee say this. Had he followed more carefully what Chatterjee does claim about community consciousness, Chibber would not have been surprised by Chatterjee's materialist account. No one familiar with the Bengal countryside and its agrarian history will argue that peasants have little or no consideration for their individual self-interests. The sense of individual property was well developed in agrarian Bengal even before the colonial land settlements. The latter introduced stricter and more codified definitions of the respective rights of different grades of proprietors and tenants, almost always defined as individual persons. It was sometimes remarked in the early 20th century that the sense of mutual cooperation among peasant families in Bengal in the matter of agricultural production was relatively weak, as was the sense of common property in comparison with the owner peasants of southern India, not to speak of so-called tribal communities among whom individual property in land was almost non-existent. It would have been absurd for Chatterjee to deny that individual self-interest was indeed functional, even prominent, among Bengal peasants. Chatterjee's claims about the activation of community relates not to the social and economic transformation of everyday rural life, but only to what he carefully designates as political struggles. By this, he means the antagonistic confrontations, never very frequent, between peasants and the formal structure of state power represented by government officials and big landlords. These moments of confrontation were extraordinary events. Chatterjee's evidence suggested to him that whereas peasants may have pursued their individual self-interest in their routine economic activities, such as defending their plots, mobilizing family labor, selling or buying crops, taking or repaying loans, etc., they acted out of a sense of collective solidarity when defending their political claims against the colonial state and landlords. In eastern Bengal, where most peasants were Muslim small tenants facing big landlords and urban moneylenders, mostly Hindu, the political struggle quickly took on religious overtones. In the southwest, where the pursuit of self-interest under favorable economic conditions had led to differentiation among the peasantry, there were conflicts between large farmers and sharecroppers, but these were suspended at moments when there emerged a political struggle between peasants and the colonial state. The rhetoric employed in these struggles itself emphasized the distinction between the economic conflicts of self-interest and the political conflict in which community solidarity, described by real or imputed bonds of kinship, was expected to prevail. Chatterjee is indeed claiming that there was a discontinuity between the everyday and the extraordinary, the economic and the political, the domain of self-interest and that of community solidarity. The dynamics that prevailed in one did not pass smoothly into the other. The pursuit of individual self-interest in ordinary times did not mean that the bonds of community were erased. They could be brought into play, sometimes with remarkable suddenness, at moments of political conflict with state power. Chatterjee's claim fits exactly with Chakravarti's, that the political consciousness of peasants and of industrial workers who had still not ceased to be peasants was different from that of the bearer of abstract rights in civil society and the abstract citizen subject of the bourgeois state. That difference is the ground for Chakravarti's distinction between reasons and interests in the political sphere. Reasons are derived from beliefs, interests from needs. Chibber criticizes Chakravarti for suggesting that only reasons are culturally constituted but needs are not. Hence, once again, Chibber does not notice the solidly Marxist providence of this distinction, derived from Hegel's analysis in the philosophy of right of civil society as the system of needs, a domain where the fulfillment of needs through economic self-interest creates abstract right, whose recognition within the laws of the state lead in turn, could I get 5 minutes more, please?
Yep.
To the constitution of the abstract citizen subject. This is the understanding of civil society and bourgeois state that Marx adopts and both Chakravarti and Chatterjee follow. But Chibber prefers to abandon Marx's view altogether and instead plumps for a wholly different conception of needs. Chibber claims that there are certain basic needs that are understood in every culture. Hence, even though they may give rise to specific culturally framed reasons, we may impute to people who give such reasons the perception of universally existent needs. Hence, he declares that there are some needs or interests that are independent of culture. Anthropologists may squirm at his mode of argument, but Chibber traces the interested pursuit of basic needs to, quote, a component of human nature. Of such universal basic needs, he then picks out one, namely the simple need for physical well-being, as the most relevant need in the context of the political struggles of workers and peasants. Indeed, he does not stop there, recounting the long history of struggles by workers in Europe to defend their political rights. Chibber announces that they follow, quote, from the defense of a single basic need to defend one's physical well-being. This, he declares in bold capitals, is the universal history of class struggle. The philosophical sweep and arbitrariness of these statements by Chibber are staggering. At one extreme, by deriving political actions from a single universal propensity of human nature, he aligns himself with an entire tradition of early modern philosophy that leads directly to the contractarian school of liberal political thought. At the same time, he invokes in his support the contemporary economist and philosopher Amartya Sen's concept of basic needs, completely forgetting that Chibber's own derivation of basic needs from universal human nature would put him squarely in the camp of what Sen calls the transcendental approach, from which Sen scrupulously dissociates himself. At another extreme, the motivation to defend the universal need for physical well-being, as described by Chibber, is independent not only of culture, but of modes of production, state formations, power structures, and all other historical configurations. Slaves, serfs, peasants, workers, everyone could be said to be defending this universal need. Indeed, if physical well-being is so universal a motivation, it is hard to see why the subaltern classes should be the only ones pursuing it. Why should not the non-productive classes also defend their own need for well-being? Finally, the pursuit of physical well-being emanating from human nature suggests some kind of universal biopolitics. Or is it zoopolitics, since animals are also known to pursue and defend their need for physical well-being? In short, Chibber's universal history of class struggle is materialist universalism run amok. Chibber clearly has little patience with rhetorical techniques such as irony. That is why he reads Chatterjee's statements on reason as a Western imposition on non-Western nationalism as blatantly Orientalist propaganda, little realizing that reason with a capital R, which is what Chatterjee consistently uses, is an obvious ironical play on Hegel's philosophy of world history in which reason can properly belong only to the West. Chibber's suspicion about Chatterjee's Orientalist sympathies is confirmed by the latter's argument that non-Western nationalism began by claiming sovereignty over an inner spiritual domain. I'll skip over this because this is not a point which Chibber mentions, and we're running out of time. Chibber is perplexed that Chatterjee, even after dismissing Gandhi's anti-modern alternative as unrealizable, nevertheless criticizes Nehru for his plans for state-led modernization. Surely, Chibber says, Nehru made a rational response to real constraints. Chatterjee, of course, had shown that without the anti-modern, anti-capitalist, anti-industrial maneuver by Gandhi, the peasant masses could not have been mobilized by Indian nationalism, and Nehru's leadership subsequently established over a sovereign post-colonial state. In that case, Gandhi's intervention was either the greatest confidence trick in political history, or, as Chatterjee argues, it must be justified by the mysterious working of objective forces that bring about the universally destined result, regardless of the ideological motivations of particular historical players. That is what Hegel called the cunning of reason. And Nehru, like all other post-colonial nationalist leaders, had accepted it as the real compulsions of the global system, as Chatterjee puts it. For Chatterjee, this is the prison house that state nationalisms are forced into, even though their political practices acknowledge every day the real presence of historical difference. Chibber announces several times in his book that the historical differences pointed out by subaltern studies scholars are all perfectly compatible with the universalizing tendency of capital. Extra-economic coercion, consciousness of ethnic and religious identity among industrial workers, cultural construction of reasons for political action can all be assimilated within the same universal history of capital common to West and East. Hence the distinction between history one and history two, which is Chakraborty's distinction, is for him a non-problem. Indeed, he simply conjures away the problem by proposing a definition of capitalism so capacious that it would bring a blush even to the pale cheeks of Adam Smith. We could, of course, turn Chibber's claim around and say that capital's journey in the East has at last revealed its true face that had been hitherto hidden from us by its liberal mythology. In Western capitalism, we saw only a shy debutant. It is the confident maestro who now performs in the East. Were this true, it would be the sweetest consummation of the project of subaltern studies. Unfortunately, that happy ending is not to be. The historical problem confronted by subaltern studies is not intrinsically a difference between West and East, as Chibber repeatedly insists. The geographical distinction is merely the spatial label for a historical difference. The difference is indicated, let me insist emphatically, by the disappearance of the peasantry in capitalist Europe and the continued reproduction to this day of a peasantry under the rule of capital in the countries of Asia, Africa, and Latin America. That is the crux of Chakraborty's distinction between history one and history two. Derived from Marx's own separation of historical conditions posited by capital itself and conditions that it merely finds. That is also why despite the apparent similarities, subaltern studies could never have been carried out in the same way as history from below in Europe. The recounting in the latter body of work of the struggles of peasants and artisans in the period of the ascendancy of capitalism in Europe was inevitably written as tragedy, since the ultimate dissolution of those classes was already scripted into their history. Should we assume the same trajectory for agrarian societies in other parts of the world? Does a different sequencing of capitalist modernity there not mean that the historical outcomes in terms of economic formations, political institutions, of cultural practices might be quite different from those we see in the West? Do those differences not imply in turn that the process of primitive or primary accumulation of capital has to be carried out in many countries of Asia, Africa, and Latin America under conditions never encountered in the history of Western capitalism? That is what is at stake in Chakraborty's distinction between History 1 and History 2. Implication is that contrary to the historical method Chibber prefers, getting one's European history right is not going to deliver the magic formula to solve the problems of historical change in the non-Western world. The historical specificities of the political, economic, and cultural institutions and practices of those peoples, including their distinctive linguistic traditions, must be given primacy by the historian. Nevertheless, Chibber's plea for continued faith in the universal values of the European Enlightenment deserves a final comment. Universalism has been defended with far more subtle and sophisticated arguments than Chibber has mobilized in his book. One can only acknowledge that the debate between universalism and its critics continues and will not be resolved in a hurry. The choice between the two sides at this time is indeed political. The greatest strength of the universalist position is the assurance it provides of predictability and control over uncertain outcomes. It is the assurance that past history is a reliable guide to the future, which leads Chibber to insist that capitalism or the struggles of subaltern classes must be the same everywhere. He says this even though he acknowledges that the defense of political rights by workers all over the West has led to the perverse result of capitalist orders dominated by democratically unaccountable financial oligarchies. In the rest of the world, capital is engaged in battles it had never fought before, just as peasants and workers are resisting capitals in ways that had never been followed before because the historical conditions are unprecedented. The critics of universalism argue that the outcomes are unknown, indeterminate, and hence unpredictable. They accept the challenge of risky political choices based on provisional, contingent, and corrigible historical knowledge. Since its early work, which Chibber has dissected in his book, subaltern studies went in several new directions, especially after the important interventions by Gayatri Spivak and Gyan Prakash. Their historical practice does not rule out the rise of new universalist principles, but these, they insist, must be forged anew. What is certain is that the working classes of Europe and North America and their ideologues can no longer act as the designated avant-garde in the struggles of subaltern classes in other parts of the world. Historians of subaltern studies have only attempted to interpret a small part of these struggles. And changing the world, needless to say, is a job that cannot be entrusted to historians. Thank you.
First of several apologies for not being a specialist in South Asian studies. I'm a Latin Americanist. Brazil is my main country of research. And for not being a specialist in expert in subaltern studies. I think I'm here largely because I wrote an article some years back about the question of grand narratives and meta-historical issues, in which I talked extensively about Dipesh Chakrabarty's provincializing Europe. So that's my claim to being on this panel. And so forgive me if the level of my discussion of these issues is not at the same, it's not the same as my two fellow panelists. And also you'll have to forgive me because this is my fourth apology, usually five is my maximum. You'll have to forgive me because my remarks will not be nearly as well organized and coherent as my fellow panelists. I wrote some things before the panel based largely on Vivek Chibber's book, And but I've also added some things as I've heard the two talks go along, and I'm going to try to integrate them in a somewhat coherent fashion, but we'll see how coherent it ends up being. Michael Schwartz on the panel yesterday on Vivek Chibber's book mentioned that he actually regarded Vivek's book as perhaps more useful as a guide to future work rather than as a critique of past work, that is a subaltern studies contribution to scholarship. In a sense, I think that his argument about basic needs is appealing at a moment when, because of the lasting impact of the cultural turn and the linguistic turn, mainly in history and literary fields, but to some extent in the softer social sciences as well, that there is sort of no notion of a sort of foundational category. And so I think there is a certain appeal, particularly to people involved in any kind of social struggle, to have some access to a foundational category. But I do think that some of the reasons for the social slash linguistic turn are also clues to why foundational categories were seen as problematic in the first place. Now, I think for me, many of Vivek's critiques of subaltern studies, which let me say, I think the title of the book refers to post-colonial theory, but I really would insist that it's a book about subaltern studies, not about post-colonial theory in a larger sense. Even if I think some of them are perhaps harsher than necessary, I do think some of them are also persuasive. In particular, in this article I wrote about grand narratives, I pointed out that some of Chakrabarty's arguments in provincializing Europe sort of seem to be edging into a certain kind of Orientalist approach, a sort of people without history approach. And I'm sure he would argue that's not what he intended. But in effect, we are responsible for writing texts that make it clear what we intend, not for writing texts that we can then later say, no, that's not what we intended. But what I would say in response to Vivek's criticisms is that I would urge us to be careful not to assume that any emphasis on difference or alterity is equivalent to Orientalism, or that, and I think, first of all, we have to be very careful, just as, for example, I think we have to be very careful about referring to something as racist. I think we have to be very careful in terms of referring to something as Orientalist, or to assume that a critique of Enlightenment reason should be dismissed as a defense of Orientalism. I think, first of all, it's extremely important to place Orientalism in its historic, Said's notion of critique of Orientalism in its historical context, because he's talking about a discourse that emerges as a discourse of colonial domination. And so that gives it a certain meaning and valence and significance that other kinds of perhaps reification of alterity does not necessarily have. In addition, I think the issue of the critique of the Enlightenment, of Enlightenment reason, is something that's very ambivalent in subaltern studies. And just to go to the most recent book in the texts that Vivek discusses, Dipesh Chakrabarty in the final pages of Provincializing Europe says, we need universals to produce critical readings of social injustices. And he also, at another point in the book, refers to the Enlightenment as a gift to us all. And so, in a sense, I think what he's arguing is perhaps what Chatterjee was arguing, which is not that we're rejecting universals, but that we don't necessarily allow a certain particular political segment of European or global northern segment to decide what those universals are. I think this has been particularly clear and particularly important for the field of gender studies. And and particularly for rethinking the nature of feminism. I think one of the ways in which post-colonial theory, and I actually think post-colonial studies makes more sense than the phrase post-colonial theory, because I don't think there is a sort of coherent body of theory, but a set of studies that help us rethink certain issues. But I think that post-colonial studies has been particularly important in the critique of a sort of Western-based feminism, starting with the classic, you know, Under Western Eyes of Chandra Mohanty. And so I think, as he I'm sure knows, his book is really gender free. And I think that if you engaged more with the category of gender and not as a category that's irrelevant to the discussion of class, that perhaps some of the debates around the issue of gender and gender relations, and particularly of what it means to be a feminist, and the a priori assignment of certain characteristics to, you know, male and female, that that comes out of a certain kind of liberal feminism. If you had looked at that strain of post-colonial studies, that perhaps you might have had a somewhat different approach or a different response. Now, if I can just talk about what I'm most comfortable talking about for a few minutes, which is how historians have approached the question of alterity and sameness or universal characteristics. It's in one of the advantages that historians have is that we study the past, and but we also talk about the past as another country. And I think we can, when you study, particularly if you study the distant past, for example, the medieval period, you can avoid certain kinds of tensions and disputes that come up when you're studying the more recent period or the present. But even in studying something like the medieval period, you can see in the historiography a sort of alternation, a fluctuation between historians emphasizing how similar people were in the medieval period to us, how they felt the same way about their families, how they cared the same way about relationships, how they cared about satisfying their basic needs. And then you have a shift to historians saying, no, they were radically different than us. They had a completely different sense of self. They had a completely different religion infused all aspects of their daily life. There was no notion of a private world. And so there's a constant tension going back and forth between this emphasis on difference and similarity. And I think that this is a tension that is, again, historians can kind of operate with this because they're the, you know, nobody's coming back from the medieval period and saying, how dare you say that? But in fact, I think that's a tension that all social analysis is fraught with, this sort of alternating between emphasizing difference and emphasizing universality. So I think that one could accuse Vivek sometimes of, if his comments about a sort of Orientalist tendency are sometimes correct, I think we can also say that in his own work, because of his desire to avoid that at all costs, that there is a kind of flattening, a sort of over-homogenization of human experience. At the same time, let me say that I think it's very important. I want to read, it's a little bit long, but a quote from an article by Arif Derlich in this book, Genealogies of Orientalism, where he says, Said suggested that the solution to overcoming Orientalism may lie in the cultivation of a decentered consciousness that resists totalization and systematization, something I take it along the lines of multiculturalism, although I'm not sure that's what Said meant. If Derlich's analysis based on the contact zone has any validity, this may not be sufficient because Orientalism itself may be a product of a consciousness already, if not completely, decentered. There is no self-evident reason why a decentered consciousness should not find relief in culturalist fundamentalism, or the reification of ethnicity and culture. The history of Orientalism provides evidence of this strong possibility. Multiculturalism, ironically, may enhance tendencies to Orientalism in its insistence on the cultural definition of ethnicity, which reifies cultural origins at the expense of the historicity of both ethnicity and culture. So I think here it's you can see embedded in this quote, on the one hand, a critique of a sort of radical critique of the solution to Orientalism as multiculturalism. At the same time, you can see the way in which multiculturalism emerges out of an attempt to move away from an emphasis on similarity. So I think there's this constant tension that informs our discussions of these issues. Coming back to a point raised yesterday, and I touched on before, again, Vivek's book is not a critique of postcolonial theory, but of subaltern studies. And with the exception of Chakrabarty's Provincializing Europe, most of the works he critiques are not of recent vintage. But I would argue, what I would argue is that scholars and activists who have consumed aspects of subaltern studies have, by and large, moved away from the emphasis on alterity or on tortuous notions of alternative modernity. Over the last two decades, concepts such as hybridity, which makes an Orientalist tendency very difficult to sustain, have emerged as major influences, especially in the more literary fields. And despite the challenge of various challenges to it, I think Gayatri Spivak's widely cited work on the subaltern's voice certainly has challenged any neat division of East and West. Just in terms of my own field, Latin American history, the appeal of postcolonial studies for historians has manifested itself in a number of different ways. First of all, one of the most important tendencies in the last 15 years in terms of the field of Latin American history is the emergence of the idea of popular liberalism, which emerges out of rethinking the role of peasants, particularly peasant communities, in political life in 19th century Latin America, and as well as the concept of everyday forms of state formation. So connecting to what Partha Chatterjee said about community and communities coalescing around challenges to state power, I would say that that has been an very important contribution to the emergence of this concept of political liberalism. What I would say, however, is that one of the arguments that's been made in the Latin American context, and I have no idea if it would work in a South Asian context, but I think it's worth considering, is that these confrontations in the context of the 19th century have also produced changes within the community, political changes and changes in authority structures within communities. So it's not simply the community as given confronting the state, but the community in the process of confronting the state being somewhat transformed. I do want to also say that while, since you know, peasants were crucial actors in Partha Chatterjee's presentation, that it is true that peasants were very important actors in 19th century Latin America and in certain, maybe the first half of the 20th century of Latin America, but by the time we're getting to the second half of the 20th century in Latin America, the peasant populations in most countries are actually very small. And in fact, during the period in which peasant populations were important politically in Latin America, they were also important politically in much of Europe, particularly Central and Eastern Europe. And I also want to make the point that in talking about post-World War II Europe, it's very important in the immediate post-World War II period that we're talking about a region that has gone through the worst military conflict, in what I think arguably in the history of the world, in the history of humanity, and that has still large portions of its population that were involved, directly involved in fascist movements, and still have fascist politics. So I think it's very crucial to understand not that this is the triumph of bourgeois liberalism in Europe, but I think in some sense a defeat of the very most reactionary aspects of European politics. Finally, I'd just like to say that in many ways, I admire Dipesh Chakrabarty's Provincializing Europe. I have to say, my own reading of it is not because I think this is the correct reading, but it's what I get out of the book. What is most important to me in the book is his meta-historical point about the way in which the global north has, in effect, been the source of all historical universals, and that has ultimately marginalized the production of historians, and of course also of political actors in the global south. So it's not just a matter for historians, but for other groups as well. So I think his project to provincialize Europe is an extremely important project. I do think the alternative he offers of sort of creating a sort of a realm that is outside of the sphere of the bourgeois liberal project is not working. People that has not been taken up by historians. Many historians who appreciate his critique of a Eurocentric historiography have not taken up the second part of his project. But what I do think has become increasingly influential among historians in terms of provincializing Europe is to move away from a notion of diffusion and sort of make a radical critique of diffusion. And I think sometimes in his book, Vivek Chibber points at some possibilities for this. But I think at other times, because of the strong emphasis on universalization, he seems to be arguing for diffusion. Supposedly, none of us are arguing for confusion. Yesterday, several times during the panel on the book, the phrase was used, when capitalism arrives. I know that's a shorthand. I know that's an attempt to very quickly refer to a much more complex process. But I think that it also betrays a certain assumption about diffusion. I mean, sometimes it's easy to think about capitalism as like the blob in the Steve McQueen movie, you know, getting bigger and bigger and consuming all in its path. And of course, Vivek and everybody else who has spoken recognizes the very uneven impact of capitalist diffusion. So what I'm talking about here, though, is not its uneven impact. What I'm talking about is not seeing this as a historically even process and not seeing even the nature of capitalism as necessarily being shaped entirely by European sources. Surely capital rarely arrived, not capitalism, but capital rarely arrived in a society where there was no market culture, no notion of accumulation, no differentiation in access to material resources. So in a sense, I would argue that we think of capitalism as expanding, but again, not simply like the blob in the Steve McQueen movie, and that might be the best way to provincialize Europe. Thank you.
When you write a book like this, you wonder what the response will be. And typically, you try to write critiques of people who you think will respond in a way that's reflective of their own work and a careful engagement with yours. I'm afraid what Partha did today is not that. So there's not much I can say, to be honest. Partha, much of his response is to the effect that I had misrepresented or misunderstood the work. I have to say, I'm not entirely surprised. I'm disappointed, but I'm not entirely surprised. The readers will have to make up their own mind. Is it a legitimate and defensible reading of Guha's that he doesn't actually think that his arguments rely on an understanding of what actually happened in 1640 England and 1789 France? Is it merely a critique of the historiography of those regions? I'm not actually sure what that means. I don't know how you can critique claims about those revolutions without reference to facts about those revolutions. I just don't know how you can do it. I think what Partha said at the end might suggest that what he was actually doing was he was referring to facts not about the revolutions, but about to 1950s England. And he was only making references to a mythology about the revolutions. You'll have to read the book. It's not true. You just have to read it, and Partha can make a case for it, fine. He also says that Guha doesn't mean capitalists, he only means lawyers and professionals. Not true. I thought he would say this, and I was going to bring the relevant pages and passages from, but why do it? The fact is this, there's three generations of scholars committed to this. It's not only Partha, I expect a whole army of people to show up insisting that I've misread, misrepresented, misunderstood these arguments. You'll have to make up your own mind. Readers will have to make up their own mind. I tried very, very hard to be as scrupulous and fair as I could. I might have, of course, failed, but that's going to be for the reader to decide. I do think what Barbara said is true. Sometimes what people want to say is not what they end up saying. It could be that Partha's and Dibesh's intentions when they talked about universalization and Orientalism and the specificity of the East may not have been what comes out from their writing. I had no way of divining their intentions. I could only respond to the writings, and whatever misinterpretations I might have had, I tried to leave ample room for them by reproducing the relevant passages in the book, and you'll have to make up your own mind. Partha also says I misunderstand or misrepresent the arguments about the peasantry, and once again I plead people will have to make up their own mind. He does make one important analytical point, two actually, that I think one can respond to. One is that my arguments about abstract, he says my arguments depart from Marx. I don't care. I really don't care. Maybe they do. I never made any argument in the book that is simply based on a textual fidelity to Marx. The only time I bring up Marx in any textual way is the idea of abstract labor, and I try to defend his category of abstract labor on independent grounds. Now, what those grounds are, Partha says here, that I think capitalism is simply market dependence, nothing more, but you can't have the category of abstract labor without a proletarianization of labor. Yeah, I think that's probably true. I'm not sure that you can't have a labor viewed abstractly simply in a simple commodity producing society. I doubt that you can. There's never been a simple commodity producing society. What that debate is, I'm not sure. The fact is it makes no difference to my argument. My argument about abstract labor was, insofar as you have a fully proletarianized labor force, does it require that that labor force be homogenized over time for the category of abstract labor to have purchase? And what I argue is that did not. Partha actually sidestepped that question. He never addressed it as far as I could see. There was a second issue, which is, don't I agree that the slower disappearance of the peasantry in the global south from the north means that it will follow different paths? Yes, in fact, I would say whether or not the peasantry disappeared rapidly or slowly, it still would have followed a different path. That's not the issue. And this imputation to me that, and here I would distance myself a little bit from Barbara's presentation of my views. This imputation, and you should be ready, it will be made every time somebody critiques my book, that I think it's all going to be the same. The whole book is intended to show that a commitment to universalizing categories does not commit you to the prediction that the East will follow in the tracks of the West, and yet it is insisted time and again that that's what I'm saying. It will be, in every critique this will come up, it will also be said that I think they're not Marxist enough, and this is just predictable. So my answer is absolutely it'll follow a different path, but that's not the issue. The issue is, what are the categories that might have some value in analyzing that path? And I have said those categories can draw upon, very fruitfully, the inheritance of the Marxist or the Enlightenment tradition. Of course not, uncritically. And the idea that I'm saying is you just unpack them, bring them over here and say, here's your blueprint. Again, you'll have to read the book to see if this is true. Finally, Partha says that I hold to a view of needs that is independent of culture, in which I place physical well-being as one of the most important ones, and which might be effective and have generate motivating reasons for people across cultures. Let me emphatically say yes. That is exactly what I believe. Would anthropologists faint? No. some anthropologists would take offense because anthropology has gone very heavily in a culturalist direction. But in fact, there's a pretty robust debate among anthropologists, and the recent issues of their key journals have had just this debate. And for those of you who are interested, two things. There's a very wide set of literature out there on some kind of experimental design on how people respond to situations, testing their perception of their interests and their perception of what's good for them. And it's remarkable, the findings have been very similar across cultures. This is reported in the anthropological journals. If you want to see recent work encapsulated by Sam Bowles and his colleagues in anthropology journals and in economics journals, set this up, and it's amazing what the findings are, which is more or less this. People are not utility maximizers, but they have a robust sense of certain minimal conditions that they feel all institutions should meet with regard to their needs, and if those needs are met, they are willing also to have a limited degree of sacrifice and well-wishing for others as well. Exactly what we think in our everyday situations and the people that we meet. So I do hope that. About Sen, again, Sen and Martha Nussbaum, who's been his collaborator for years, and Sen has never said he disagrees with her, in fact has written several articles defending the concept of human nature. In fact, listing the components of basic needs that she thinks, not based on transcendental arguments, but an inference on evidence, both anecdotal and experimental, basic needs that are effective and valued by people across cultures. This is from Sen and Nussbaum. So I think that's a questionable reading of them. I do hold to the contractarian tradition. Let me proudly say, I hold to the contractarian tradition of political philosophy, which says that democracy requires a basic respect of people's fundamental interests and a recognition of those interests. I think that's about everything I wanted to say. Let me leave it at that. Thank you.
The argument in Subaltern Studies was, I don't think, ever an argument about peoples without history. It was about people with different histories. And I would emphasize both different as well as histories, because as soon as you bring in histories, I think the whole argument about Orientalism simply can't be sustained. Orientalism is not about histories. Orientalism fundamentally denies the historical character of Oriental cultures and claims something essential, which is unchanging. And that is precisely what is contested by that entire recent tradition of the social anthropology of South Asia since the 1950s and 60s. That's precisely what that material, that very, very rich and productive literature based on detailed field investigations. That's what it's produced. And that was largely the kind of empirical basis of the argument about culture that Subaltern Studies wanted to draw upon. It is also completely true, as Barbara said, that the history of resistance, political struggles by peasant communities often leads to the transformation, even breakup of peasant communities. There are many things that one would be able to say, I've myself written on this, about the difference between the kinds of studies that Vivek has studied. This is the early work of Subaltern Studies on colonial and early 20th century peasant resistances in the whole colonial period. I think the historical impact has been a change in the very configuration of peasant communities and their modalities of politics. These have changed. These have changed particularly in the last 30 years or so. But this is where the important question comes in. I don't think it can be argued that this is just a slow disappearance of peasantry. This is something which I and many other people would seriously contest. Because what is being reproduced are conditions of the social existence of a peasantry under conditions of capitalism. They are being reproduced systematically. I think the whole distinction between what's called the formal and informal sector of labor in India, and the informal sector basically consists of something like 85 to 90% of production. That informal sector is not operating either with a fully proletarianized labor force. The same commodities are being produced in these two sectors under entirely different production conditions and yet competing for the same market. Now, this is a completely different kind of dynamic that's been introduced. We still don't know what name to give it. We still don't know what this leads to. But this is very, very different from anything that has been experienced in Western capitalism. Which is why I think this whole argument, one of the things that never comes up in Vivek's book, as far as I can remember, is the idea of primitive accumulation, which is absolutely central. How is the process of primitive accumulation to be managed under conditions of electoral democracy where everybody has a vote? This is an unprecedented situation in the history of capitalism. We still don't know what this leads to. But I think this is precisely the kind of thing that subaltern studies historians have been confronted with. Now, in doing this, yes, we were led into taking Marx seriously, Marx in his own terms, and trying to understand how you use categories of Marx developed by Marx in order to analyze a situation which Marx never experienced. And those are the kinds of arguments about historical difference that comes in. Now, Vivek, of course, says that he doesn't care if his definitions are not according to Marx. He doesn't care if he even says that he's fine with contractarian liberal political theory. Well, these were not our assumptions, I have to say. They still are not. It is a question of being Marxist in a different way. That was the project. And we led somewhere. It moved in very different directions. There are many other people who are engaged in similar kinds of arguments. We don't occupy the whole field. But that is where subaltern studies was. And the legacy is precisely this, to consider capitalism under conditions of historical difference. It's a project which I'm quite certain is going to be with us when we consider the enormous impact that let's say Chinese capitalism is going to have on the world. It's a major project intellectually. We've done only a small part of that. Thank you.